Hello, this is Tommy. Welcome back to ChIP-seq. In today's video, we will continue to produce a figure from a genomics paper. So in that paper, the authors produced a lot of ChIP-seq data. For example, YAP, TETs, TET4, ChIP-seq. And we're going to actually reproduce the figure one from that paper. Make sure you watch the other videos in the same playlist so you have a context. And today we will try to reproduce figure 1, G, and H. So first of all, you need to analyze what kind of plot type are they. So for figure 1, G, if you are familiar with ChIP-seq data analysis, you instantly recognize this is just a IGV track view for the raw signal file, the big wig file, and which we actually produced in the previous video. Make sure you check them out. And for figure 1, H, this is just a pie chart, and for the peaks that are common among those three transcription factors, YAP, TETs, and TET, and then you annotate them, whether they are promoters, whether they are active enhancers, inactive enhancers, or not classified. So once you get the number, then you can easily actually make a pie chart. Okay, so for figure 1G here, as I said, this is just IGV track view. So I already loaded the bigwig files for the YAP, TETs, and TET4, so those are the raw signal files we actually generated in the previous video. Make sure you watch the previous video to understand how to do that. And I also added the peak files that are called by MAX3. So as you can see here, MAX3 actually correctly identified the enriched peak regions from the raw signals, like here and here in the CCN2 gene promoter. And you can see here in this light blue color here, this actually identifies the highest peak within that peak. So they call it summit, okay? And as you can see here, actually those three transcription factors, many of them are overlapping with each other in terms of their binding regions, right? So you can easily just make a screenshot and from IGV and then make a figure. And you can change the colors. For example, if you want to change colors, you can just say, okay, change track color. So you can change them to red, for example. And you can really make really nice figure just by using IGV, right? So, but fundamentally, this bigwig file is just a histogram, okay? So if you remember, if you just zoom in, and you see this is just a histogram, right? And it really depends on the bin size that you use. So for example, like this, probably it's a 50 base pair bin size. Let me see if you can further zoom in here. And then you see this is 51 base. So it's roughly 50 base pair per bin, right? And what actually the big wig file, how that is calculated is you count how many reads that fall into this 50 base bin, base pair bin, and then you get the average, and that's the value for that bin. Okay, so it's really not that mysterious once you understand the basics. Okay, let's go to figure 1H. This one is a little bit more complicated because let's see how the authors define promoters, active enhancers, and inactive enhancers, or not classified. Okay, to do that, actually, we know actually H3K4 monomethylation, this is an enhancer mark, and H3K27 acylation is an active enhancer mark, and H3K4 trimethylation is a promoter mark. So you can read this. This is actually a previous data sets that authors downloaded in the same actually cell line, MDMB231 breast cancer cell line. Okay, so they download the previous data and then use that to annotate the overlapping peaks among those three transcription factors. And you can read actually there's the paper I believe from Keji Zhao's group, and they provide histone modifications. I think it's this one, it's a cell paper, and they profiled a lot of histone modifications in the human genome, and they actually defined, okay, H3K4 monomethylation, for example, is an enhancer mark. For example, H3K4 trimethylation is a promoter mark. So this was probably back in 2008, something like that, 2007. Okay, you can read that, but for us, what we can we need to do, we need to actually download that data set. So if we go to that data sets, it's taking some time to load. Let's see. Those are the files that we need to download. Those are the bat files or the peak calls from Max. H3K27 oscillation, active enhancer H3K4 monomethylation, just regular enhancer, and H3K4 trimethylation is a promoter. Okay. And they are all produced in the same cell line, the MB231. Okay. So essentially, just download those files. Okay. It's not working at this moment. Okay, but anyway, I already downloaded them. So you should see this actually in the bottom of the page if you click that link. And I already downloaded them in the public data folder here. Okay, so those are the three files that I downloaded. So those are just the bat files of the peaks. If you look at the one of the files and you see essentially those are the max2 peak calls. It's a bad file, chromosome start and end, some name and some scores here. Okay. But the problem here is that we actually aligned this old data sets using HG38 human genome. And this peaks files, those are in HG19. So we need to lift it over from HG19 to HG38. Okay. So to do that, we need to use this tool called LiftOver. It's from UCSC. If you go there. So there is a LiftOver. So you need to also first download the chain file, which maps those two genomes, HG19 and the HG38. So you know, okay, the region from HG19 maps to HG38 for a certain region. Okay, so this is the chain file H19 to H38 that you need to download, and you can just use this command to download that chain file, and also download that lift over. It's a binary executable which you can use that to lift over H19 coordinates to H38, and don't forget to make it executable. U means user plus X. X means executable. Lift over. Okay. So essentially this command. So you can do lift over. And if you do that, it will give you all some of the help page. And the command you need to use actually is just very easy. So you just lift over. This is your input bat file. And this is your chain file. And this is your output file, HGK27 acetylation. And then you have the unmapped file because some regions, they are not mappable between those two versions of genome. So unmapped one bat. So you can do that for all three of them, okay? So after you have done that, so you end up with these three bat files and also these three unmapped files. And you can look at how many lines there. So you have like 31K, 26K, and this 18K peaks for each of them, okay? Okay, you remember we only called peaks for those three transcription factors, and of course you can use bat tools intersect to find the overlap among the transcription factor and also the histone modifications. But just to be consistent, I will do everything within R. Now let's go to R instead. Okay, I think it's GNH, so let's go here. Okay, so first of all, let's load some libraries, R-track layer to read in the bat files. Here, dplyr and ggplot2. And now we can read in the TADS file, the peak file for TADS, for YAP and for TAD4. Okay, so if you look at my data structure, so let's go back, and then you see data, FASTQ, and then TADS peak, and then the nanopick files will be there. Okay, so this is the file path. That's why I'm using this file path here. Okay, so our track layer will import those files as a genomic ranges object, right? And we can do an overlap for those three. So we can first do yap overlap with tads, then use the subset by overlap function from genomic ranges package. So yap peaks and tads peaks. Those are the common ones between those two. Then you can further overlap this with the tad 4. And then you can subset with this and then the tads 4 peaks. And this is the common peaks among those three transcription factors. And you see now you end up with around 36,000 peaks. Now we can read in the histone modification peaks, right? Use the same import function. Okay. Okay, this is from the method section, right? Essentially how the authors define whether it's an enhancer, whether it's an active enhancer or promoter, right? So it says the presence of HTK4 mono and the HTK trimethylation peaks. Okay, so if it's a HTK4 trimethylation not overlapping with HTK4 monomethylation peaks and close to a TSS, so those are defined as promoters. And if it's HTK4 monomethylation not overlapping with HTK trimethylation, we're defined as enhancers, right? Okay, and promoters or enhancers, they were defined as active if they're overlapping with H3K27 acylation. So if you have common peaks of H3K27 acylation and H3K4 trimethylation, those are active promoters. And if you have H3K4 monomethylation and H3K27 acylation in the same place, those are active enhancers. Okay, so we can just do that. Okay, active enhancers we can do, okay, subset by overlaps. So if they have both of them, will be the active enhancers. But if you only have K4 monomethylation but not HTK27 acylation, those inactive enhancers. And the promoters will be HTK4 trimethylations but not overlapping with K4 monomethylation, for example. Okay. Now we can just get the numbers, right? Now we need to annotate all those peaks. So this is a common peak among those three. And then those are the active enhancers, and let's see how many of them are overlap with the peaks. And then we just get the length, essentially how many of them are active enhancers. Right. And you just see how many of them. So, okay, actually you have almost 4,000 of them are active enhancers, most of them, right? So inactive enhancers, now you subset by overlap. So this is the common peaks among those three. This is the inactive enhancers. Look at the length. So only have 118 promoters here, the same thing. Then the unclassified will be just everything else, right? So you just get the numbers here now. 274 here, unclassified would be 1,600 something. Okay, so once we have all the numbers, now we are ready to make a pie chart. So first of all, we need to put them all into the same data frame. Okay, you can just do that. And then this is the active enhancers. This is the number that we get from here. And now we're ready to make a pie chart using ggplot2, okay? So ggplot2, the data frame that we have, then use, okay. It's like just a bar plot by using the coordinate polar. And then this will give you a pie chart, okay? And we can change the order of the categories by changing the factor levels, okay? Promoter first, active enhancer later, inactive enhancers, and unclassified. So use the factor function to re-level the factor levels here, okay? Do that. And now we can change the color also manually. The same ggplot, We are using the menu color here, and also we change the order of the category here. Let's do that. And this is actually very similar to the original figure. Okay. Yep. And then we can also add the percentages of those peaks in each category. So we just need to calculate that first. So we use, so this is the original data frame, for example. Now we can use dplyr mutate and add another column called percentage, and it equals to the peak number divided by the sum of this column times 100. Okay, if we do that, and now we have the percentage here. Now we can recreate the pie chart, but now we are going to add another geometry underscore text, and will be label equals to label here, and then we'll have the percentage that's labeled here. Okay, so that's how you can actually reproduce figure from a genomics paper. So once you understand how the data is structured, what kind of data you need to make that figure, and then later you can put all the necessary data into a data frame, you're ready to make any figures if you know how to use ggplot too. And nowadays, just make sure you ask AI, ChatGPT, it will always give you some starting point of some code. Okay, that's it for today. Happy learning, and I'll see you next time.